And welcome to our community. Susie Thomas here with you this morning and joining us. Delighted to welcome two people very involved with the Monroe Community Center in Northeast Canton. We've got Joyce Sumlin, who I believe is one of the very beginning executive directors, and Melvin Copeland. Melvin, please tell me what your role is with the Monroe Center.
I am the facilitator for the Monroe Center.
Mm-hmm. Great. And Joyce, tell us a little bit about your involvement since 2004. But before that, let's go back to the history. I believe you had said that it began in 1998. Tell us a little bit about the history of the Monroe Community Center.
Yes. The Monroe Community Center, that's located on 2000 3rd Street Northeast, is one of the oldest fire stations in the city of Canton. It was existence for a while, and then they turned it into a library, and then they transferred over to a community center.
So that's got to be an interesting building. Let me stop you right there first before we go on. You're in an old historical fire station.
Correct.
So everyone wants to know, is the pole still there, and what does this inside look like?
It has very high ceilings, very large space in the lobby where the fire trucks were actually parked at. It still has the original trenches in the basement where they put the hoses and stuff. They did have the pole there for a while, and of course they took it down. So it's amazing. It has so many different compartments there. And they're even, like up at the attic, we see some stuff up there, but I won't go.
Okay. Well, I'm imagining very large rooms because this would have housed fire trucks.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us then the transformation into the Monroe Community Center. How did that come about?
There were some citizens before my time. Dora Walker was one of them and some other people. He's deceased now. And they talked to the past Mayor Watkins, and they said they wanted something in their area. So they got together, and they got a group of them, and they started the Monroe, area, mm-hmm. because they just didn't want to sit in there. And then someone called me years later and said they kind of needed my expertise because it was just like a low key, you know. So I came in with some help with some other people. Jeff Fisher, that owns Fisher Foods,
sure.
His son came in, and they did some work for the bar mitzvah, mm-hmm. some things they did. And then Star Community Foundation, they came in. They funded some things. They've been with us for over 10 years. So these people really see needs in that area, and they did it, you know, without any complaints or anything.
There's an old saying that says just find a need and fill it, and this seems to be exemplary of that. Tell us about some of the services. I know you have quite a few programs that you offer.
Yes. Two of the programs are really near and dear to my heart is it's a girls mentoring group called Proud to Be You. It's a self-esteem, also educational group for young ladies 7 through 18, but we won't turn anybody down. If they're in transition and they're doing something else, we'll still let them come in. Also, we have a Boys to Men mentoring group, which Mr. Copeland facilitates. Mm-hmm. Also, Ken Kendall, he's a former head of security for Kansas City Schools. Tony Townsend, he is a president of city council for Mass, and he's also one of the mentors.
Can I stop you there again? I'm curious to know what this looks like. Are young ladies provided with individual mentors? Do they meet as a group? And then, Melvin, I'm going to be coming to you asking the exact same question about the young men.
Okay.
Tell me, building self-esteem in women, tell me what that looks like as far as the program.
We started out with a group. And we came all together, and we did, like, activities together. Sometimes we would see a need where some of the girls would just sit off by themselves. So that's when we had to do individual talking to, and because they didn't feel comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
But because of my training, I'm a certified foster parent, and I've did some training in OPATA down in London, Ohio. That's mm-hmm. a BCI training. So I know how to deal and what to look for with the suicide, the trauma, because I've been trained in that. So when the young ladies start, like I said earlier, sitting by themselves, or everybody's coloring, or they're doing a life map of what they're going to be 5 or 10 years from now, and someone is just doodling, that shows me that they're really not there, and there's some other issues going on. So the answer to your question would be there's group activities, and then there's one-on-one. If there's some things I can't handle there, then, you know, we make referrals to, like, the Mental Health Recovery Board. They have services that are very, very good. They can really help these children. They're one of the best-kept secrets, too.
They were on our program 1 week ago.
Yeah.
So, oh, yes, great. I know exactly what you're talking about. And, yes, they do some marvelous work. Why is that so important? What do you see in young women from your experience maybe today that they're dealing with that they didn't have to deal with maybe 5 or 10 years ago? I know the obvious answer would be the technology is so brutal sometimes to some kids. Mm-hmm. But
well,
from your experience,
videos,
what do you see?
It's television shows. Television shows shows these young ladies that you have to be stripper material.
Oh, my.
Long hair, a size 5, stilettos, 4 or 5 boyfriends that have money, or they call it bling. If you don't fit in that category, then you're not a part of the team or part of the in crowd. So what happens to those young ladies, they drift off into the sunset. So they'll go to the computer. They'll be on the computer all the time. This even happens with boys. Yeah. When boys feel like they don't fit in. That's where I think something needs to be put in place at colleges and also at schools early for the mental detection, because if you have a student at college that keeps showing you warning signs, oh, he's just a loner, oh, he's just going through some things, then you really need to hone in and radar on that, because that might just be the individual that...
Those are the danger signs.
Those are the danger signs. So I've seen that, and I look at some of the young ladies, and those young ladies were me. Mm-hmm. Because of my weight when I was younger, you know, back then, I grew up in the 70s, and you had to have a certain look in the 70s, the hippie look or whatever, and if you didn't have it, you already know the rest of the story. Mm-hmm. So, and I grew up in a small town, Maslin, and Maslin really wasn't the most hippest town. And so, but then when you got to Canton, you had to fit in. So they're trying to fit in because of society. They're trying to fit in because when they look at Facebook, they see all these different things. I really feel sorry for this generation.
You know, what you're saying, though, is not new news. We've known this for years. We've known that models and magazines are airbrushed. They don't even look like that. And we know that this idea that this fake person on TV that everybody must ascribe to looking exactly like, we've known that that's false. I'm asking you, why mm-hmm. 10, 20, 30 years later are we still dealing with this?
Self-esteem issues, I hate to say, but at the end of the day, looks, sex, booze, drugs, it sells. Mm-hmm. It sold in the 20s, 60s, 70s, it really sold. And now 2015, we're still there.
It's a heart issue, isn't it?
It's a heart issue. Families, I think there needs to be more family activities. I talk to the parents. If he mentors boys and I'm mentoring girls, and I send them back into a household that's doing the same thing. So I said, what we need to start doing is have a family dinner each month. Because a lot of families don't sit around for dinner because mom working 3 to 11, dad working midnight, blah, blah. So I want to bring something back with that family structure, like that cleaver. I know everybody's not going to come to these dinners once a month, but the families that do come, that makes me feel good, because maybe if I touch one family, yes, that's good with me.
That's one very simple place to start, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Melvin, this leads me to the Young Men's Program, because I've read time and time again how important the father figure is in the home to developing not just the self-esteem of the young man, but the self-esteem of the young woman as well. To have healthy relationships with between father and daughter makes a huge difference on how a young lady looks at herself when she gets a little bit older and into dating and so forth, that it makes a difference in the choices that she makes. Tell me about what you do with young men to address these things.
Okay. Me, myself, I grew up with just one parent.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because I lost my mom at such an early age.
And my dad,
he would never was home a lot. So I practically raised myself.
Wow.
And I can relate to some of these situations concerning these young men, because I've been there myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I try to get over to them how I grew up and what I did to stay away from alcohol, stay away from drugs, go to school, you know, get your education, you know, because it's so important. And this is what I try to do, and this is what I try to stress to those guys.
Yeah, no pressure, Melvin, but do you have any idea how important the role is you play in their lives? They are looking to you as such a role model.
Yes, ma'am, I do. And that's why I enjoy what I do.
Mm-hmm.
Because I tell you, it's just truly fascinating to me to see these young men and where they are now and then what they can grow up to be later.
Oh, it's huge.
It is. It is.
Tell me what that looks like then, day to day. What do you do with them, the kinds of activities you experience with these young men?
Well, I try to talk to them and tell them the right things, you know, in life and the choices that they should try to make if they can. And nobody's perfect, by no means. So, and these are kids. So you have to try to balance it, you know. You just can't just try to take and just try to force them. You have to be able to work with them and do and say the right things and try to make them feel, because a lot of these kids are in single family homes as well.
Right.
So you have to make them feel comfortable, number one.
Mm-hmm.
And by that, I mean just talking to them the right way. You know, I mean, I do security work. I've been security officer since, probably 28 years.
Mm-hmm.
So I see a lot of things, and I do a lot of things in the community. Because, I mean, a lot of it, I work with kids. I work at soup kitchens. So I see the low of poverty kids.
Yeah.
So I try to help them out the best that I can with just being a man, a young man,
yeah,
you know, and try to just be respectful.
Well, thank you to both of you. We are speaking with Joyce Sumlin and Melvin Copeland, both of the Monroe Community Center, located on 3rd Street Northeast and near Monroe, on Monroe.
Mm-hmm.
That's where it gets its name. And the work that you're doing with young people and the difference that you're making in their lives is just so commendable. And what we're doing here today is letting people know that you are there. And do you find yourselves mostly working with families just in that neighborhood, or is it extending beyond your region?
It extends beyond our region. We have a bus, and you'll be able to see our hippie bus when you put it on the Facebook page. And one of our goals is that we want to service all Stark County, and that's even including Maslin. We have a mentor from Maslin, and he's really excited. But we have some challenges along the way.
And you know what? I have to stop you there. I just looked at the clock. We've got a break, and okay, we'll be right back after these words with more. You're listening to Our Community.